Hello, everyone, and welcome to this live event, which is part of our Tech Founders series. During this series, we'll be exploring the career stories behind the founders and not necessarily always founders, more on that in a second, of some of the world's most exciting technology companies. My name's Harry Gooding. I work here at Hays, and today we're extremely excited to be joined by Mark Schonberg, who is the Chief Strategy Officer at 2B3D. Which is an organization that is dedicated to helping veterans combat mental illness in the decentralized metaverse. If that doesn't make any sense to you yet, we will cover off exactly what that does shortly. Mark has an amazing story to share with us today and his unique view as a chief strategy officer who works closely with a range of founders in a very exciting space. We are, as always, streaming live to LinkedIn and YouTube. And if you have any questions for Mark regarding his story or work or things that come up during our conversation, please comment and we'll answer as many as possible during our live Q&A shortly. Mark, thank you so much for joining us and welcome.
Thank you so much, Harry. Thanks for the Hays team for having me here this morning. I'm really honored.
No problem. And you said this morning because you are, of course, not sitting in the southeast of England like I am. Where are you today, Mark?
I am in a lovely Hollywood Hills, and so, I've got a nice view of downtown, at least for a few more days, and I'm not dealing with the LA traffic, which, like I told you earlier this morning, is not to be rivaled by the London traffic, which is much worse, but I think LA is a close second, and that's where I'm at this morning.
And we have a lot of people dialing in from all over the world. And I suspect there's one or two people who would think they know traffic even worse than ours. But we won't spend our time talking about traffic in different countries, despite the temptation. Mark, can we start with some obvious stuff? Let's start with some introductory type stuff. Can you tell us a bit about you and your career to date?
Yeah, so I did 34 years in the United States Army. Retired as a colonel. I was an IT and cyber guy that entire time, managed global IT infrastructure. And then about 2006, when the cyber, offensive cyber, defensive cyber, computer network awareness, the vulnerabilities, really people started looking at that. I was essentially in the right place at the right time. We set up the first Army Regional Cyber Center in Europe, actually in Wiesbaden, Germany. And I was part of that. And then I went over and led all cyber development for the Army, which was a great job. Did that out of Fort Meade, Maryland. And then went over to Korea, moved the Allied forces out of Seoul, 50 miles south, $16 billion project. It was really the first smart city. You know, we didn't call it a smart city, but it truly was a city designed, 565 buildings, 44,000 people, designed to be on the network. And so then I retired and did a lot of work with the data center industry. I was lucky enough when I was in the Army to be the guy who they turned to. It was a curse when at the time, but in retrospect, it was a blessing, right? Yeah. So did a lot of data center work, and I've had the privilege of meeting some just phenomenal people in the data center industry, guys doing cutting edge stuff with renewables to support that incredible energy demand. And somewhere along that way, I was approached to be an advisor to a company called 2B3D. And their mission was a metaverse company. But it was also, they were all veterans, just like me, or the majority were, and to end veteran suicide. And so it's a really unique business model because they're leading with their social mission first. And, you know, obviously the metaverse, there's chance there'll be business opportunities to make a profit. You actually, you know, you've got to make a profit to do good with your charitable work, right? But the fact that they were starting off focusing on people was really, really a powerful message to me. You know, Harry, I spent 34 years in the Army, lots of places that weren't very nice. I was the IT guy, so when the bullets started flying, I ran the other way while the young kids ran forward. But, you know, the most powerful stuff I ever saw making a difference was the medical folks, the people that would engage the local community. I told you earlier, I'd been in Morocco. I saw a team of doctors go out there with Bedouins. And, you know, they removed cataracts from a man who hadn't seen in 10 years. Or they get a young child who needs glasses, that's never had them, new glasses, and they see the real for the first time. And so that stuff is powerful. And the team I'm with at 2B3D, you know, we want to take that and we want to take it to the metaverse, because we believe that that access that the metaverse offers to people that are disadvantaged can really equal that playing field. And at the end of the day, save lives. That's what it's all about.
Well, let's get into that, Mark, because that sounds like a perfect kind of transition into a little bit about 2B3D. Now, it feels to me, and I'll let you explain what it is, like what you've done here is applied some absolute cutting edge technology to universal problems and challenges that are felt universally. So tell us a little bit, what does 2B3D do?
So we're a metaverse company. So let me back up a little bit, because the story of the founding of the company's interesting. Rob Bell and Andy Bjornson, they started this company back when they were in high school. It was called 5150, which ended up being a famous snowboard company, if you're familiar with that. I'm not a snowboarder, but everybody who's a snowboarder that's my age tells me they know exactly that company.
You notice I just nodded along there, Mark. I sort of just nodded. I didn't say it. Yeah.
And so so they started that. They sold that and went off. Rob did a medical solutions company, which is essentially linking doctors with lawyers because for insurance purposes. Andy went to school to do VR stuff, gaming, USC. He enlisted in the Army as a combat medic, went to Afghanistan, has a combat medic badge, and came back, and Rob noticed, hey, you know, my friend's a lot different. And it's PTSD, right?
Right.
And so that was kind of the aha moment, you know, for Rob. And that's, you know, we linked up shortly after that. But, you know, many people on this call will have, you know, because NATO was deployed to Afghanistan, you see the stuff going on in Ukraine and Russia. When you get somebody in those kind of circumstances, you know, PTSD is natural. And PTSD, it doesn't discriminate whether you're a good guy or a bad guy, depending on how you sit. And then it also flows down to your family.
Right.
And, you know, when I was sitting here listening to this, I thought to myself, gosh, all the people I knew from World War II, from the Korean War, and a lot of them had issues, and that trickled down to their family. And then in the U.S., at least the Vietnam War. And so it's really a family problem. And now, you know, luckily with the emphasis on mental health in the last few years, people are talking about it openly. It's not stuck away in the closet anymore. I mean, you know, I'm 54. I'd never heard the term PTSD until I was probably in the Army for 15 years, 2004, 2005. You might hear something called shell shocked or something like that. And so it's finally getting the attention. Mental health is finally getting the attention it deserves. We're starting with veterans. But then we quickly, because of the metaverse, we could change the wallpaper. It could be a teen center. It could be an LGBT trauma center. It could be something we give to kids in the Ukraine that are displaced. And the technology behind it, to get back to your original question, the technology behind it is just now coming online. Things like Starlink, 5G, because it does require an extreme amount of bandwidth to stream, you know, the environment. However, it's just getting better every day.
Yeah, fantastic. So in kind of in quite simple terms, partly just for me, if you don't mind, What is it that a veteran who maybe has suffered with PTSD, if they do engage with 2B3D, which is your organization, what kind of things might they be doing, and what's the business doing with those sort of people?
So the first thing we're focused on is crisis support.
Right.
And you know, that's keeping people from killing themselves, right? When they're in that, I've got the gun or the pills in front of me. How do I get past that? Well, first of all, you put on your VR goggles and that gun and pills are no longer in front of you.
Sure.
You can't see them. So it changes your environment instantaneously. The other thing it does, it allows you to do group therapy. And so, you know, like the traditional phone crisis support lines, the global 988 suicide is a great, wonderful effort. For every life it saves, it's worth it. But it doesn't really allow you to maximize your medical staff, your therapy staff, and it doesn't allow you to use any sort of group treatment. Well, VR does. You know, it allows you to be in a group of people that are similar to your situation. It allows you some anonymity, you know, hey, I don't know who you are, but it also, because of the way we're managing it, and I can get a little bit more technical discussion, ensures that you don't allow people who aren't authorized to be there or shouldn't be there in that room. Right. And so if I have 20 people on a phone line triaging 20 individuals, well, 21, where does the 21st person go? Our vision of this is you have the triage, you pass the group therapy, and now that therapist number can handle 10 people at once in a group as opposed to that one-on-one setting. And it's been shown to prove pretty effectively that for that immediate type therapy, group therapy is much preferred to individual therapy.
Wow. I mean, incredible. It's kind of incredible work that you're doing. And to your point earlier, there's so many applications for what you're talking about. So, you know, your role in this organization is chief strategy officer. And for everybody listening who's wondering why Mark isn't the founder, I hope that from the type of business he works in and the stories he's got, there's plenty of reasons we're talking to Mark today. But what's your kind of role then in the business? And you know, and what's the plan? What's the strategy? Tell us a little bit about that.
So based on my history, which is IT services and cybersecurity, what we're really doing is we're laying out that strategic roadmap that melds all these things together. Somebody said to me the other day, well, I go to your website, you've got 5 or 6 different things on there, and you guys should really only be focused on one. And my comment to him is, you don't understand cyberspace. You don't understand the metaverse, because it's all based upon layers and functions, applications and platform. I mean, look at your phone. You know, if you have an iPhone or a Galaxy, you've got 100 in your phone, and they're all layered in that same network. And that's exactly what we're trying to do. So I design a medical clinic. Ours is on a space station. You can go, if you go to our website and see the beta stuff, it's pretty cool. Now I layer in, and what we're going to do, we're going to use NFTs for identity management. People say, well, you know, NFTs, those are those crazy online graphic art forms that people buy. Cool. Everybody around me buys them. I'm not into it, but they are. But no, that's not what we're looking. We're looking at the supply chain security aspect of NFT for identity management. And so that allows you to be irrefutable who you are. Two, you can go into an environment, be anonymous, but also you can go get a prescription, you could get an order, you get referred to additional therapy. And then if you don't like the group counseling, but you want to do individual meditation, a cognitive behavior therapy module at the ocean, below the ocean, on the top of Mount Everest, at a Buddhist monk, on the moon, you can do it. And then that allows you to track that stage of progress for that individual. And so it really, it's dynamic and how you treat. It's not one shoe fits all type approach. Yeah. And it's really leveraging the technology. And so I've just rolled cybersecurity. I've just rolled identity management. I've just rolled in your treatment and how we're tracking you. And I'm doing it in this metaverse environment that, believe it or not, is fun. It's supposed to, we're going to design it to be fun, so you're not doing the traditional therapy where you're reading a 400-page book. At the end of the day, what we'd love to do is have that crisis support line, but we'd also like to have some of the gamification aspects treat some of the mental health aspects. And if you'd like, I can go more into that as well.
Yeah, it's really, I mean, I would like to have all afternoon to talk about this stuff. I think it's really, really all morning or all evening, depending on where you are. But I think the thing that strikes me is the challenge that your organizer, and we talk about this a lot on this series, is what's the problem that the business is solving, or what's the issue that it's addressing? And what you've started with, you know, the way we started this conversation is people at crisis, potentially with PTSD, who are coming out of ginormous institutions like the military. To what extent is that problem statement so vast and also sort of such high stakes that it's, you know, how does that influence the business and the business plan? And I ask because from my point of view, it's the sort of thing that's it's sort of so massive and so complicated that it's intimidating, but I suspect for someone like you, it's also kind of exhilarating, is it?
It is, you know, the statistics are all over the place. The U.S. Veterans Department released some statistics the other week saying that they'd seen a decline, which is great. But we believe roughly about 45,000 veterans kill themselves every year in the U.S. Not every year, excuse me. Kind of sum total, and it's about 6,000 a year. And what we believe is that those numbers are drastically underreported. And they're underreported for a lot of reasons, mostly because the way it's counted differs, at least in the United States, differs by every state. And, you know, obviously every country in the world is going to have a different level of that. But we're trying to focus on saving one person at a time. That's really what it's about. And so if you can create this environment that allows for that fellowship to heal each other, to get people through that hard time. Because when you're in the military, at least in the United States military, and I have several sins in the UK military, there's a lot of similarities, but there's some differences as well. The minute you're not part of that anymore, your entire social structure is gone. I used to ask myself, well, how do all these people who worked for me that were super responsible get out and have all these problems? Well, that's because you're living almost in a sheltered community, right? Now you're asked to go to really nasty places and do, in certain cases, some nasty things, right? In combat zones. And now your entire support structure is gone. All the stuff you used to get tax-free, now you're paying taxes. So many of the veterans go into debt. And it's just a downward spiral. You've lost your social support group. You've lost your ability to earn an income for your family. And it's just a terrible downward spiral. But really, at the heart of it is we believe if we can start with veterans, that's the toughest nail or toughest nut to crack, so to speak. And then it'll be easily exportable to these other high-risk groups. And so we want to start targeting veteran suicide, but we want to expand it to all suicide. Because really, that's the goal, is to take technology and, you know, I had a phone call the other week. We were talking about cyberbullying. Well, my point to those folks was, well, what's the end state if somebody's traumatized at? The end state's suicide. And so taking that same technology that allows people to bully people and now turning it into a tool that can potentially treat them, that's really what we're trying to do. And you've all seen it. Everybody who's a parent's seen it. Your kid gets on that video game. And those dopamines get released, and they're just so focused. Well, imagine taking that power, gamifying it as much as you can for a treatment, and now using that for good. And that's our ultimate end state. You know, we think doing the crisis support center is a natural first step. I love, like I said earlier, I love the 988 line, but the telephone was invented in 1876, so we probably need an infusion of new technology. And that's what we're trying to do.
Mark, it's inspiring to hear you talk. It's inspiring to hear about the mission the business is on. And I'm sure there are lots of people on the chat who've got questions. So just an encouragement for anybody who is listening to post any questions they want to talk about. I've got two or three come through already that we've noted down, but please do ask questions. Mark, I'm very conscious that we're speaking to someone who's done 34 years in the military and transitioned into what certainly from here looks like an incredibly exciting opportunity in a startup. And and doing amazing work. Is to what extent is this mission that the business is on and the fact that you're working there, is this informed by your own experiences? And did you go through this same transition, and was that as difficult as it sounds?
That's absolutely, Harry. You know, I'm a pretty stoic guy. I'm not very touchy-feely. Sometimes to my detriment, right?
Yeah.
But I had the same thing that happened. I moved for a new job. I was working with a data center company. They, interestingly enough, they ended up moving to Switzerland, and I wasn't going to move to Switzerland because I just left Europe. Yeah. But that whole social network was gone. And so I'm experiencing these same things that I saw on the other side. And there's nobody to pick up the phone and talk to. There's nobody, you're not going into work surrounded by your comrades that every day are in that same environment.
Yeah.
And then you reach out to your own group that is retired. And most of them are in the same situation that everybody else is. So it's just, it's really a difficult thing to tackle. But if we don't start with the difficult problems, it's we're never going to get there. And what I would just say, when I started working cybersecurity, it was just abysmal.
Right.
And now it's amazing. I mean, you have an incident, and not only can you get it classified, but all the support data, all that says, hey, this is what this is, when it occurs, this is who's probably doing this, this is what's probably causing it. And why not take that same technology and use it to address mental health? I mean, we can have a bigger discussion on medicine in general. Yeah. As I know, there's several people that I've talked to, pretty prestigious doctors that are talking about 3D modeling of like cancer cells in the metaverse, because right now all your modeling is done on, it's a biopsy. It's a two-dimensional slice of something under a microscope.
Yeah.
And so, at the end of the day, we want to address mental health. We think this is a great way to do it.
Yeah.
But it also leaves the door open for so many other things. We're not replacing the doctor. We're not replacing the therapist. But, those places are only open certain times of the day. Those doctors they can't work every day of every week. And we're going to fill in that gap. And, somebody's suicidal at 1 a.m. in the morning, they can't go to the mental health clinic to get help. And if they're, 100 kilometers away, they need to be able to access it directly. And that's what we're trying to do. It's not as great as being there in person, but it's the next best thing.
Yeah. And I can't really speak on behalf of media coverage in the States, but certainly here in the UK, mental health amongst young people during the pandemic, during these times of kind of deep economic uncertainty, the talk of global recessions, the cost of living crisis, mental health is a theme that is very present. And it feels certainly here like it's got more attention and more focus now than ever. Question one, is it the same in the markets or the communities you work in? And secondly, is that helpful for you and your business that this is that the media is using this as a big theme and a big theme for global media organizations too?
Yeah, so it is. But I would caveat that with is everybody likes talking about it, but nobody likes talking about any solutions, right?
Right.
And, in the way that we're wired, we want instant gratification. We want to order from Amazon and we want it at the house 2 hours later, right? Yeah. And mental health is very nuanced, it's very later. For example, one of our partner companies that we're working with, a company here in California called BioCore RX, they're working on a treatment, an anti-addiction treatment. Because I may have issues, mental health issues related from PTSD or something else, but odds are I probably have some sort of an addiction problem. So how am I going to treat my mental health aspect if I also have an addiction problem? And it just layers itself. And so, one of the saddest things I would ever show you is if you were here in LA, I would take you over to the Veterans Center to see all the homeless camped out in front of it. And it's incredibly moving and incredibly sad at the same time, because you have all these homeless with, and most of it's mental health and addiction issues, right? But most of them still have American flags up And so it's really, you know, it's kind of chokes me up, but it's something that people have talked about, but nobody's really getting after. And now what I'm seeing is people are legitimately coming to the table finally. And some of this might just be a matter of technology finally getting to a place where it can really help people.
Yeah.
Stepping up to get some of these hard problems solved. And that's what's really exciting to me is I can take all this knowledge I learned from this other stuff, from IT networks, cybersecurity, building data centers, delivering services. And now we can wrap that up in an environment, in a metaverse, and we can give that to people. I can literally go along and hand out these goggles to people who are in need. And that's really where we want to get to. We want to get to a stage where people who need help can get help and they're not stigmatized. So yes, it's all over the media.
Yeah.
But in many cases, I think it's just, in a lot of cases, it's just designed to get a story. None of those stories end with a way to treat it. Or it might be very localized in a local clinic that's doing, you know, great, incredible work in their community, but it's not something that we can export to the whole.
Yeah. Thank you, Mark, for those answers and for the honesty during this chat so far. It's been really, really, really helpful. I've got a couple of questions I'd love to ask you that have come in from the people listening. So the first one is, it actually sounds extremely helpful for people with mobility challenges too. So to your point about being able to actually get to the doctors or get to the clinic or get to the surgeries, that's a huge challenge as well. Is that front of mind when you're thinking about product development? Is it actually supporting those with potentially accessibility issues and other things too?
Absolutely. I mean, that question couldn't be more right on what we're talking about. Not only from a distance to drive or get to the person that you need help for, but again, that time aspect. Yeah. You know, one of the things that we just witnessed within our company, we have several people that work at the company that are classified 100% disabled for PTSD. And you know, there's issues with that, right? So, you know, they'll have emotional breakdowns on conference calls or meetings. But we understand that's part of their trauma. And so we work through that. But one of our individuals had an appointment with a psychologist, had waited 2 months for this. They hung their, and this is one of the things when you have anxiety and stuff, you hang your hat on these things that really aren't that big of a deal, but they become so magnifying to you as a big deal that you consider taking your life because of it. And drove to his appointment, and you know, heaven forbid, the psychologist was sick that day. I think they had COVID. So of course they're not coming into work because they can't come into work. And you know, now you've just triggered that individual. And so with VR, it just allows us, to maximize this medical therapy workforce that is shrinking because of COVID, because those people just got so beat up during COVID. It allows us to maximize that resource. It allows you to have your therapist with you, and your therapist might be in the UK and I'm in LA.
Yeah.
But you can still have that interaction. So addressing those mobility issues is really one of the paramount things behind doing this in VR.
Yeah, that makes total sense. I feel this is the sort of question that comes in that it's easy to just think it's slightly outside of norm, but I think it's important to ask. You mentioned about the goggles as a requirement for individuals to take part. You talked about the strength of the bandwidth required to keep these rooms up and usable.
Yeah.
To what extent is sustainability and environmental impact part of the discussion with your founders and or a consideration when you're thinking about developing these products?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So first of all, we look at it, the whole ecosystem. And so the data centers, the backend platforms, you know, all this stuff runs through a data center, right? We're looking at doing that. You know, we're not going to host it anywhere that's not at least a good chunk of it renewable energy based, right? Because, you know, we're very conscious, you know, 100 megawatt data center is enough to like power the entire city of Los Angeles, right? I mean, it's insane the amount of power. So first of all, responsibility just doesn't start at the headset. It starts with the power, which is the very basis for all IT, right? If you don't have any power, you don't have any IT services. And then as we go through this process, you know, we're trying to make our product platform agnostic, which means it would work with any set of VR goggles. And then we're also working with, you know, the folks at the very end to make sure that we can have a system in place that rewards folks for using this. And then when I say reward, it's almost like that game type system, right? And so you're positively reinforced for participating and getting treatment. And so the environmental aspects from the production of the headsets, you know, we haven't done a deep dive in that. We're really right now we're in the technical design development that will play a part because we don't want, you know, we don't want to work with companies that are not responsible. But the other thing too, as you said, the new technologies, this wouldn't have been possible 5 years ago. And so as we work with the next generation of VR headsets that come out, like PlayStation is going to come out with a new PlayStation VR. We're very excited to see how that works. There's some new pixel streaming companies. If you're familiar with the gaming industry, there's a new product out. Unreal Engine 5 is out. It's incredible, Harry. I mean, it really is like being in the real world. It's, or you can be, you know, it's like, hey, I want to be Gandalf today. I'm in the Lords of the Rings environment, right? It's it's amazing. But the pixel streaming platform that's associated with that is really revolutionary. So we think those problems that have traditionally plagued a lot of this stuff are going to be less and less and less. And so, you know, 25 megabytes download speed should be able to get you what you need for this environment. But again, as far as the ESG portion of the message and being environmentally responsible, for us, it starts at the first link of the chain, which is the data center backend, and we're very selective of who we're going with there.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. And I think it it certainly feels like for the big vendors as much as the individual organizations, ESG and sustainability are much higher up the agenda. So it makes sense that with advancements that will improve. Now, unbelievably, the time has flown by as they always do, but particularly today. I do just want to end with a bit of a nice big open question for you. So again, mindful of the people we have on the call and the individuals that may have joined from your network as well. But you know, at this point, traditionally, we'd ask a founder to say, what advice would you give, you know, a founder who's in your situation, but before they hit the big time or got successful or whatever. But for you, I'd love to ask a slightly different frame on that, which is just, you know, 34 years in the military, you've transitioned out of the military into a successful career now, working in startups and tech startups and mental health, an incredible start. Is there any advice you've had at any point in that journey that actually still resonates for you today? It's still advice that you either think about and reflect on or that you pass on to others?
Yeah, you know, it's a wonderful question. Sustainability, you know, I had this canned speech when I was in the Army because it's all about sustainability. As you go through your product development and within what we're laying out, the VR space, the data center space, I mean, there's so many value chains. There's so many places where you could make money in this, you know, to revenue against. It's insane. But you have to start out with something that's sustainable. And if you don't have that sustainable back end, I was working with some of the world's biggest battery manufacturers, super cutting edge, replacing lithium ions because of some of the work I'm doing with IT and data center stuff. But they just could never get the manufacturing and the sustainment. So the best ideas in the world, they could never really get to market because they could never meet that service level agreement for the sustainability. Right. And it's whether it's IT, you know, a lot of my friends in the IT will come to me and say, because, you know, I did contracts for the government. I mean, I've spent billions of dollars on procurement. It's what happens with your product if there's an issue at 2 a.m. in the morning. Who do you call? And so you have to approach these technical problems with that foundation is, okay, I might have the best widget in the world, but if somebody calls me at 2 o'clock in the morning, how is that going to get fixed? And so that's my advice to people, especially in the technical space. You really have to look at sustainability in your ecosystem. And if you can get that solved, it's so easy to pivot. So an IT help desk could also be, a cybersecurity virus help desk too. You can integrate these capabilities into that sustainability infrastructure that you have to support your product. But if you don't have that, you're never really going to get the most out of your product. And it has to start with what's my plan long-term, not just the ones and zeros are really cool. Nobody else has a product that does what I do, because again, your mousetrap might be really good today, but I'm telling you, 6 months later, somebody else is going to have a better mousetrap. And if you can sustain it, then you really increase the life cycle of your product over time.
Mark, thank you so much for joining us today. That has been a very brilliant, very quick, but very brilliant conversation. I feel like
Harry, if I can, real quick, I'm going to plug our website.
Please, where can people find out more? Yeah,
it's two B three dimensional.com. We launched today for Christmas, we launched 2B3D.games, which I didn't even know was a domain, but now that's a domain, .games. And what we're doing there, you can go order your cool 2B3D bling, candles, hoodies, and everything else. And really, it's designed for people who want to support our efforts in addressing suicide, ending suicide. So again, thank you so much for having me on today.
I know. Thank you, Mark. And that's 2B3D.com to find out about the business, and 2B3D.games to find out about the merchandise and other ways you can support. Okay, good.
Yep.
Everybody, please do take note if you'd like to find out more. And that is it. So thank you so much today, Mark, for joining us. Thank you for your insights. Thank you for your candid conversation around all sorts of very important topics. I've really enjoyed the conversation. And for everybody who's listening, if you would like to rewatch this session, the recording will be available across our social media channels and our website shortly. And of course, if you would like to find out more about Haze, how we can support your career, how we can support your organization, do have a look at our website, which is expertsintechnology.haze.com. Thank you, everyone. Thank you again, Mark, and speak to you all again soon, I hope.
Thanks, Harry.